if we're not talking about who is the right advisor, which is the right advisor to solve the continuity problem, then we're not talking about anything at all. If we're talking about which is the right advisor to solve the continuity problem, is it the ego or is it the Holy Spirit? Then we're using our time wisely. Otherwise, we're not using our time wisely. We're doing nothing, actually. So when we go to school, in the classroom, and we're listening to what's being said, is the teacher saying, everyone, we need to focus on which is the right, who has the solution to the continuity problem? Is it the ego or the Holy Spirit? If you're not hearing that, you're doing nothing. You're not hearing anything at all. Same thing with television, same thing with your friends, same thing with the family, etc., etc., etc. There's only one issue in the entire world, in the entire cosmos, who has the solution to the continuity problem? Is it the ego or the Holy Spirit? There are no other alternatives. It's either the ego or the Holy Spirit. Those are the only two options that we have. Which one can solve the continuity problem? And so when we're focused on that, then we're really on point on the issue. There's only one issue in the entire cosmos, only one issue. Who has the solution to the continuity problem? Is it the Holy Spirit or the ego? There are no other third parties involved. The ego tries to say there are third parties involved. There are not. So that's my position. It's my position now. It will be my position forever. So everyone knows what my position is on everything. There's only one issue. There are no other issues. There's only one issue. And who has the solution to the continuity problem? The ego or the Holy Spirit? And you, when you look at like that, then you begin to clarify this issue. When you spend your time clarifying this issue, more and more and more and more and more you see the answer to this. But you have to do the clarification for yourself. Nobody can do it for you. Because you have to see. The ego is very jealous of the Holy Spirit because the Holy Spirit has the answer, the continuity problem. And the ego wants you to remain loyal to it and say that it has the answer. So there's an extreme jealousy there. The Holy Spirit's not jealous, but the ego is incredibly jealous and competitive. And it tells us that it can do what the Holy Spirit can do. Well, the Holy Spirit was specifically created by the Prime Creator to resolve the continuity problem that Spirit has. Specifically by the Prime Creator. The ego is not something created by the Prime Creator. Was not something created to deal with the continuity crisis problem. The ego is the continuity problem. So, the ego claiming that it can solve the continuity problem, again, that has to be looked at very carefully. Very carefully. It's utter nonsense. But the ego doesn't want you to look at this issue because it realizes that if you do, it's curtains for the ego. So it desperately wiggles and struggles and tries to distract you. So again, if you're not looking directly at this issue, you're being distracted, guaranteed. By who? By the ego. The Holy Spirit doesn't try to distract us from this issue. It keeps bringing us right back to this issue. And saying, just look at this issue. So as all the stuff's happening in the world, that's not the Holy Spirit. That's the ego. Ego's just throwing all the stuff up in the air. Ah! Just whatever it can find to throw up in the air, is... Ha, 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 throwing all this stuff up in the air, look at this, look at this, look at this. And look at these issues, all these issues are so important, look at all the stuff that's happening. And the Holy Spirit just calmly says, just bring your attention back to the one issue, the only issue there is. Who has the solution to the continuity problem? That's it, that's the only question there is. That's the only concern we really have. Is we have a continuity problem. If we didn't have that, we would set this dream of death and darkness and impermanence, we would set it down instantly. Everyone, there'd be no two ways about it, would that we would set it down that quickly. But we do have this continuity problem, and so we're looking for help. Who can help us? Who can solve this for us? And the ego, of course, says that it can. And the Holy Spirit quietly assures us that it has the answer. It is the answer to the continuity problem. And so you have these competing claims, and you have no choice but to sort it out. You have no choice. That's why I say it's the only issue there is. The ego competes with the Holy Spirit. The ego insists that it has the answer. But is the ego's claim, is there any substance to it? You know, and so if you spend your time looking at this, you gradually see that the ego is just completely bluffing. Has no solution for the continuity problem at all. None. And yet it keeps insisting that it does. And so the ego wants to prevent you from looking directly at this issue, which means the ego really wants you to do nothing. Just stand by idly standing by. That's all. And it throws up again all these different things in the world to try and distract you away from this focus. Tries to throw your focus off. The Holy Spirit never tries to throw your focus off. It's always quietly, gently brings you back to this issue. So from my experience in this world, the world is really basically just idly standing by. It's doing nothing. This issue is not being addressed in this world. It has not been addressed. It's a derelict world. It's a derelict world. There was some feeble efforts to do so throughout history. There have been some feeble efforts. But efforts, some efforts nonetheless, even though they were somewhat feeble. But the ego is putting on a full court press, a massive, massive, massive effort to negate those efforts and to get us off focus, off track, so we're not continuing to consider this issue. Now, we find this issue very difficult to consider. Why? Because the ego is so competitive, and it is so unruly, and it fights against this focus constantly. So it is difficult. It is difficult. And so we do get tired, and it is a struggle. But how much more difficult is the struggle when we accept this loss of focus as something positive or something inevitable or all of this? We only make it more difficult for ourselves. The more we pay attention to the ego and its distractions, the more difficult we make it for ourselves. Because again, this is the only issue there is or ever will be, is this continuity issue. There is no other issue you'll ever have, period. Because this all of existence is a dream. It's a hypothetical scenario. It's not real. And how do we awaken from the dream? How do we set it down? That's a continuity issue. When we fell into dreams or imagining hypothetical scenarioness, when we demanded that mind present this hypothetical scenario to us of impermanence and death, so that we could learn to die to what we are, so we could become something different, greater than God. When we did that, we basically put in place the continuity problem. Because how are we going to set these dreams down is the question, right? How do we set it down? Because our creativity is massive, you see. It's not just massive. It's the creativity of the mind is endless and inexhaustible. So how do we set down all of this staging, etc.? It's a continuity issue. How do we go from learning to knowledge to knowing? How do we do this? How do we set it down? It's the only issue we have. It's the only issue we'll ever have. So how we set this down has to be our focus. And God, the prime creator, knows that this is our only problem, and therefore specifically created the Holy Spirit to resolve this problem for us, specifically. And so the Holy Spirit is there letting us know that it has the answer. And that the ego does not have the answer. The ego is really, the purpose of the ego is to teach us how to die. That is the purpose of the ego. And the mind, there is no creation of the ego. It's the mind is simply telling us that there's this advisor that can teach us how to die. So we don't think it's the mind that's doing all this. We think, oh, there's this advisor, the ego. There's some self, something that is, you know, capable of advising us how to die. Whereas really just mind that is presenting, telling us this. Sort of, we're trying to camouflage what's going on. So that's, the ego has no answer for us whatsoever in the continuity issue. The ego is simply telling us that we don't have to solve the continuity issue because we will learn how to die, and therefore there won't be any problem with the continuity issue. We'll be dead, and then we'll be resurrected as new spirit. So it says there's no continuity problem. However, it feels the Holy Spirit as a threat to its plan, to its teachings to us, to its teacherdom of teaching us how to die. So it feels so threatened by the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit enables us to set this dream down, let it go. So the ego feels it needs to compete with the Holy Spirit and compete and tell us that it has a way to solve the continuity problem, even though it doesn't have a clue. But it tries to figure out, okay, why are people listening to the Holy Spirit, and what can the ego do? How can mind present something that seems plausible, a plausible way to deal with it? So we keep our loyalty on the ego, so the ego then can keep teaching us how to die. That's what's happening. Nothing other than that. And it's very tiresome. The ego just never stops trying to distract us. Which is boring. It's boring. The dance of the ego is very boring. Continues to be boring. The more it tries, the harder it tries, the more boring it becomes. It's like, oh, this again, huh? You've tried that a million times. And now you're saying, no one improved. It's like, oh my gosh, are you kidding? Another repackaging of the same nothingness, same boringness. It's just really tiresome, isn't it? The ego's antics are tiresome. And we shouldn't have to continue to endure the ego's antics. It's just antics. Ego's antics are tiresome. It's just another day in the life of the ego's antics here, where we can choose to focus in on this issue. Well, which advisor has the answer to the continuity problem? And the ego will say, neither. Or will say, both. Whatever it is to keep itself in the picture, it will never say that only the Holy Spirit has the answer. The ego will never say that. And so ask yourself why. Ask yourself why. The Holy Spirit always says it's either the ego has the answer or the Holy Spirit has the answer. One or the other, not both. So it's the Holy Spirit's willing to teach us all or nothing. It's not afraid because it knows it has the answer. Whereas the ego will never teach that. It will always say both or neither, or the ego. Those three possibilities. Either the ego or both or neither. But never will it say that the Holy Spirit... Only the Holy Spirit has the answer to the continuity problem. So that in itself should alert you that the Holy Spirit isn't afraid to say, look, either choose 100% the ego or choose 100% the Holy Spirit. And that's the only option you have. the Holy Spirit's not afraid of that. So that should say, hey, wait a minute, interesting. And your reason should start clicking at that point. And saying that, you know, the ego is really very fishy, what the ego's up to. It doesn't add up, really. Really doesn't add up at all. So you investigate the ego's claims. You put a critical eye on the ego. You say, you know, the Holy Spirit's very steady in what it says, very stable in its position, very unwavering, very calm, very untroubled, very non-competitive. It doesn't feel a need to say like the ego is. It's not that. It's not like that. It just quietly, it goes quiet when tried to be challenged. It's not. Doesn't feel threatened or anything like that. So that seems to be coming from a position of certainty, assurance. It doesn't seem to be bluffing at all. Whereas it seems the ego seems to be the one that's bluffing. So these are questions that have to be addressed. And they're not easy questions to address because the ego and all its antics and all its bluster and all its bluff, etc., you know, clouds everything up. It's always trying to cloud everything up and confuse and get us all confused and riled up and agitated and uncertain instead of a calm consideration. Calm consideration has to be the way. The Holy Spirit is a calm consideration. So just sitting very quietly, calmly, and just looking, say, now, which one of these advisors, which one of these contenders is a pretender, and which one's the champion? Which one has the answer? There's two making the claim, which one has the answer? Or is it both, or neither? You see, these are questions that have to be addressed. And unfortunately, in this world, I've not seen any situation institutionally or collectively at all that addresses this issue. It seems to be an individual effort here in the world, where if we don't make that individual effort, we'll just drift aimlessly doing nothing. Because I can't find it, I have not found anything on this planet that really simply addresses this issue. Very simply, though. All we have to do is sit calmly and look at this question, look at this issue. How difficult is that? It's easy. If you just do it. It's not being done. I don't find it anywhere. Not really. Simply, the ego always tries to find a way around this. Always. So even in spiritual practices, it's still, the ego is still trying to find a way around it. Instead of actually actively investigating which one. Actually looking at this, actively looking at it. Which one has the answer to the continuity problem? It's not good to just blank your mind or go quiet mind or anything like that. You need to use your lookingness, your ability, your attentiveness and reason, and to clarify. You have to actively clarify this question. Otherwise, it remains unresolved. It's not enough to just quiet the ego for a while, because it'll come right back. Well, sure, the ego will pretend to be quiet for a while, as long as you agree not to look at this question. So you can spend a lifetime in meditation if you want to. The ego will agree to that, as long as you don't look at this question. You can spend a lifetime chanting mantras if you want, as long as you will agree to anything, as long as you don't look at this question. So you can seem to be the greatest guru in history, as long as you don't look at this question. The ego will set you up as top guru, as long as you don't focus on this question, as long as you don't address this question, as long as you don't look at this question. So it'll offer you anything. It'll offer you, you know, ruler of the universe, as long as you don't look at this question. And will actively help you in that direction. So the ego is frantic. It'll do anything you want, actively help you, as long as you don't look at this question. But as long as you don't look at this question, this issue, you won't have an answer to the continuity problem. The continuity problem remains, because you will not have seen that only the Holy Spirit can solve the continuity issue. So you will not jump into the arms of the Holy Spirit as it is and let the Holy Spirit transport you, you know, out of this continuity problem. You won't do it, so you will still have the continuity problem. You might be the ruler of the universe, but you still have the continuity problem, and you will still be dreaming. You will still be defining what you are. You'll still be caught in definitions, the net of definitions. So you'll still be defined as the ruler of the universe. You will have not gone beyond definitions at all, because of the fear of the continuity issue. So really, you've done nothing. So even being the ruler of the universe, even being the king of this world, is doing nothing. Not getting anywhere. You're just time idly spent. That's it, time idly spent. So as you go by your day, just be aware. Are people addressing this issue in conversation, at work, at play, in the family, in various activities that you're doing, various focuses, various entertainments, various religions, spiritual practices, education, learning, all this? Is this issue clearly being addressed, being held up, directly identified, and saying, this is what we are focusing on? Is that happening? If not, it's time idly spent. And if there's a world of time idly spent, that's the world in the clutches of the ego. And a world in the clutches of the ego is doing nothing at all. Nothing is happening. Doesn't matter what seems to be going on. Again, the ego will actively promote and work on all sorts of situations arising. And of course, in a dream, any sort of situation can arise. And although it's a dream of death, that the situation will also fall apart. But so the ego can make it seem like there's all sorts of stuff happening, all sorts of progressions happening, where there's really, you're just spending your time idly, you're just sitting by idly, nothing's happening, you're not doing anything, because you're not focused on the only thing you need to do, the only decision you need to make is, who has the answer to the continuity problem? Is it the ego or the Holy Spirit? That's the only decision we need to make. We have one decision we need to make. Just one. One problem, one decision to make, and nothing else. That's it. So if we're not looking at that, we're doing nothing. So really, nothing at all is happening in this world if we're not addressing this one issue and one decision that we have to make. Nothing at all is happening. And yet the ego can make it seem like we're doing all sorts of stuff. We're righting all the wrongs. The ego's great at that. Of course, it hates doing that because it wants to, you know, be focused on how to spirit can die, teaching us how to die. That's its real purpose, but it has to respond to the threat of the Holy Spirit as it sees it as a threat. It has to address this, and it hates that. It wants to do away with that entirely. It wants to get back to the business of death 100%. It wants to be sacrificing people at the altar 100%. It wants to be engaging in the worst, you know, mayhem and death constantly. And yet it has to deal with this threat of the Holy Spirit. So it has to appear to be offering us solutions to the continuity issue. And it's seeming to address it, even though it's not. But the ego always wants to get back to 100% focus on teaching us how to die. And so it's trying to push out the Holy Spirit, this issue, trying to marginalize it entirely so it can get back to busting heads, get back to mayhem. That's its goal. And so as you marginalize this issue, focus on this issue, you're really going in the direction of mayhem. And of course, again, the Holy Spirit has to deal with the ego has to deal with the threat of the Holy Spirit. And so it can't quite get to the mayhem it wants, so then it puts a temporary hold on mayhem by some severe control situation, so that it can bring about mayhem, boom, like that. You see? But it can't quite get there. It's always trying to get there, and sometimes it gets there pretty severely, and other times it has to back off a little bit as you say, now wait a minute, what about the Holy Spirit? And then it says we need to control everything under control, so that buttons can be pushed and mayhem can happen like that. So you have these situations in the world that, you know, the world, the history, the flux, ebb and flow of history. It's just the ego trying to deal with this threat of the Holy Spirit, and at the same time to carry out its business, which is death, teaching spirit how to die, which is impossible. So it's trying to accomplish the impossible. And that's why you have history. That's what history is. That's what the ebb and flow that you see in history, the events of the day, etc. It's just the ego trying to juggle these two situations of trying to teach us how to die, at the same time trying to prevent us from listening to the Holy Spirit and distracting us from the Holy Spirit by throwing us these crumbs of spirituality. We don't need spirituality. We need to focus on this one issue. Who has the solution to the continuity problem? Where is the solution to the continuity problem? Is it with the ego or the Holy Spirit? And again, the ego will just completely try to distract you from away from this. That's all. That's what it does. It's trying to prevent itself from dying. Of course, it's not alive in the first place. So it's all just a shadow play. It's something that eventually we'll look back on and just laugh at, but we're not laughing right now, because we're in a very dire situation here in this world, where the marginalization of this issue has become catastrophic. The marginalization of our focus here has become catastrophic. And again, how this plays out seems to be weird and uneven, because the ego is juggling. It's juggling. It wants to get 100% focus back on death, and yet it has to somehow compete. It has to compete with the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit's there. It's within us, and it's always present within us, saying, I have the answer to the continuity problem. It keeps whispering to us, I have the answer. Continuity problem, I am the answer to the continuity problem. And the ego is always freaked out about this. The eagle's always freaked out. It's always ambitious. It's always saying, well, I have to do something about this. This is awful. There's something within that's very threatening, terrible. It's the fact that the Holy Spirit is within us and has the answer to the continuity problem. That's what the ego says is terrible within us. Horrible, terrible. That if you, he says, if you accept the Holy Spirit, the ego says, I'll have to go on a rampage or something. Now, if you accept the Holy Spirit's answer to the continuity problem, that's the end of the ego. There's no rampage. It's all bluff. It's all bluff. The rampage comes when you stop focusing on this issue. That's when the rampage comes, because then the ego gets more power and presses its advantage. So the ego's, the idea that by accepting the ego as the answer to the continuity problem, that somehow that prevents rampages and mayhem in all directions is completely erroneous, just the opposite. It only fuels the mayhem and the rampage. Because again, we do have this continuity problem, so it has to be solved. And so the idea that somehow just turning the ego, everything will be fine, is nonsense. Because we desire the continuity problem to be solved. We can't, there's no way around this, no way around it. And so the ego has to address this desire on our part. And the fact that the Holy Spirit is within us is a fact. And so the ego cannot get around the facts. And so it's only plausibly, what it says is only plausible, that it, if we put all our faith in the ego, everything will be fine. No, it won't. Because the ego cannot solve the continuity problem for us. And therefore it will feel very threatened that we will find this out. And the Holy Spirit is within us, and we do have the answer within us. So the ego will still be freaked out, except that it will be able to push us towards death very severely, trying to, you know, sacrifice all these bodies and flesh and our psyche and civilization and culture, everything. It'll just pull us down much more severely, much more severely. We'll give it the rope to hang us with. So it's always the wrong move to try to appease the ego, always the wrong move. And yet, the ego can make it seem plausible that this is the right move, so it takes wisdom to see it is not. It takes wisdom to see that. And it takes calm reflection. It takes fairness. Fairness means let's listen to both sides. That's all the Holy Spirit asks us. Listen to both sides. Give a little time here and a little time here, okay? And compare. That's just being fair. So, for me, I always felt that my strongest suit was fairness. I said, I want to give, let's hear from both sides so I can make a decision. And then you, when you hear from the Holy Spirit, you say, hey, you know, you have the stronger case, no question about it. The ego's case is very flimsy. In fact, the more you look at it, the flimsier it gets. And the ego's entire case is filibuster. That's all the ego's case is to not listen to the Holy Spirit, to filibuster it. So you might say that existence is simply a filibuster. And one speaker after another gets up, one issue after another gets up on stage and continues the filibuster. All it is this filibuster. And we, you know, are watching, listening to this filibuster. Why even listen to it? It's a filibuster. You just have to say, hey, wait a minute. Okay, if you want to keep yakking away, fine. But I'm going to turn to the Holy Spirit and say, Holy Spirit, what do you have to say? The ego's having its say. What do you have to say? And then give the Holy Spirit equal time at least. And in fact, the more time you give it, the more you realize that the ego is a complete fraud. What is case is completely fraudulent. Therefore, you give the Holy Spirit more time and more time and more time and say, hey, you've got the winning hand, because I want the continuity problem solved and you have the solution. So that's what I want. That's what I'm going for. Remember, it's fairness to hear both sides, and yet we have to be fair to ourselves as well. And to be fair to ourselves, we need to decide, make a decision, and have the continuity problem solved. That's the only way to be fair to ourselves, is to solve, have the continuity problem solved. The only way. The only way we can be fair to ourselves is to have the continuity problem solved. And therefore, we must make a decision and have it solved. So it doesn't do any good to be unfair to ourselves. It doesn't do us any good. And literally, I would say the world everyone here in the world is profoundly unfair to themselves. Profoundly unfair to themselves. And they're holding this up as some ideal, like, let's all be unfair to ourselves, and then we'll all be happy. We'll have equality. Unfairness to ourselves, how can we talk about that as equality? That's a rootless, term, equality, when it's based on unfairness to ourselves. The only way we can be fair to ourselves is to have the continuity problem solved. That there is no other way. And so if we're not focusing on who has this, what is the solution to the continuity problem, who has it, we're being unfair to ourselves. And therefore we're denying our equality. Because only in reality is there true equality. Is the term equality of any meaning whatsoever. Because only reality is real. So how can you have unreal equality? It's a meaningless statement. In reality, everyone has everything. In dreams, it's not true, because dreams are always dreams of death. The dreams that we are dreaming. Now the Holy Spirit is specifically created by the Prime Creator to reinterpret dreams, to redefine dreams. So it's different than how we were created as far as our functioning. We can't change our functioning. So we cannot solve the continuity problem ourselves. It's impossible. See, when we try to have the ego solve the continuity problem, we're really saying that we can solve the continuity problem. We cannot. We cannot. We are not created to do so. But the Holy Spirit is created to do so. But the Holy Spirit is really a blessing, spirit blessing itself, as it were. It's a blessing we're bestowing upon ourselves. And yet, we were not created with this because we would have felt that the Prime Creator was intentionally desiring us to have a continuity problem so that we could bless ourselves. And that's not true. The Prime Creator did not desire us to have a continuity problem, to dream of how to be greater than God. But the Prime Creator knew that we would try to do this. So the Holy Spirit, the Prime Creator was aware that the function of the Holy Spirit would need to come into play at some point, absolutely. But we were not created as problem solvers, because there are no problems in reality. If the Prime Creator created us as problem solvers, that it would be just induce us into dreaming of death. Trying to solve the problem of how do we become greater than the Prime Creator? Because that would be the only problem that there could possibly be, is if we thought we needed to be greater than the Prime Creator. All right, just 1 minute, please. All right, so we can accept the solution to the continuity problem, but we cannot provide it for ourselves. But we can choose it. We can accept and choose it. We can accept it. See, we're able to accept reality, as it were. Say, yes, of course I love reality. I accept reality. It's not a problem at all for me. We can affirm that. We can certainly affirm. We can accept the affirmation. We can abide in that. Spirit, what we are, is capable of doing that for sure. But we cannot provide the solution, as it were, to ourselves. We cannot. So the ego, we cannot solve this problem by ourselves. Only the Holy Spirit, together, the Holy Spirit and Spirit, solves the continuity issue. by Spirit by accepting what the Holy Spirit has to offer. Redefinition. Now, there's not enough of this focus in the world. There's not enough of this focus here. And yet we still have to focus on it. We will always have to focus on this until we choose the Holy Spirit's resolution of the continuity issue. We have no choice but to continually try. But again, we can't do it for one another. It's impossible. See, the idea that somehow we, Spirit, can solve the problem for others, one another, is not true at all. It is not true. The Holy Spirit solves it for all aspects of Spirit. So the idea of just loving one another, that is not true. That does not solve it. The idea of just being kind to one another does not solve it. The idea of us interacting does not solve it. The only thing only way to solve it is to accept the Holy Spirit's resolution of the continuity issue. And so how do we interact? By helping one another focus on this one issue. That's how we do it. So when Jesus says love one another, he really is saying help one another focus on this issue. That's what is being said. Help one another focus on this issue. That has to be the basis of any civilization, any world, any society, any civilization. Help one another focus on this issue, which means calm. Can't be done in an emotional state. Cannot. It requires calm reflection. But calm reflection is not an end in itself. I mean, just being sitting here quietly, calmly. Again, no. It has to be, again, intelligent, purposeful focus on this issue. Holy Spirit, ego, wait a minute, which one has the solution to the continuity problem? I need to decide. So, in order to make a decision, one has to know the two options. You have to clearly see what the two options are so a meaningful decision can be made, a real decision, saying, oh, I know what this is and I know what this is. I'm choosing, you know, I'm making a choice now. So we need to bring the light to light, the ego's lies and deceptions and how it tries to, you know, bluff us, etc., etc. You notice it. It's a notice, and you notice it. You notice it, and you see it calmly. So there's a whole way of noticing and clarifying and becoming aware. So the agape, the spiritual love, is to help one another focus on this issue. That is the real, true attitude that is necessary in the world. Now, love your neighbor as yourself means help your neighbor focus on this issue the same way as your neighbor should help you focus on this issue too. What you want to do, which is to focus on this issue, you want to help your neighbor also focus on this one issue. That's the whole basis for society, culture, civilization, etc. So if that is lacking, if you say, wait, there's a lack of that, then something's drastically wrong. Drastically wrong. It means you're in a very dark situation as far as, you know, you just, how do you judge a world, etc.? Well, that's how you judge it. I can say I've never had a situation in the world where someone has directly help me focus on this situation. I just have not ever come across it, really. Other than a few rare kind of distant echoes, as it were. There are a few in the world who have tried to help. But as far as day-to-day, everyday things, no. As far as a culture, no. As far as a society, no. As far as a civilization, no. As far as a world, no. Nothing. Which is, of course, the ego's, what our ego wants. And it, again, the ego, we're trying to solve our own problem. Like we're God. It's just playing God. We're saying, oh no, if we were God, we'd be able to solve this. That's what we're really saying. See, we want to become greater than God. We want to be God. So we say, well, look, the way to become God is to act like God, which means God should be able to solve this problem. God can solve any problem. We should be able to solve this problem. That's just, again, spiritual pride. Nothing more than that. And how is it that I'm able to say this? Because I've spent the time in quiet reflection, contemplation, clarification. But it hasn't come about because of society or culture or civilization of this world or even teachers here. It's come about because I'm tired of suffering. And you know, oftentimes we only turn to the Holy Spirit at a time of doom, severe doom. So I felt my life was completely doomed forever. And that's when I turned to the Holy Spirit because I had no other option. I said, I have to get help somewhere. So if there's any help, I'm willing to listen. Right away, the Holy Spirit, I began to be aware that there was an intelligence. There was a confidence that the continuity problem, that something had the answer to the continuity problem. I was aware of this confidence. And the ego was, of course, very upset at that time. It tried to, because I was aware of this quiet confidence within, the ego tried to convince me that I was completely insane, completely stupid, completely incompetent, etc. It was trying to keep me from listening to this confidence by insisting that I was, you know, completely crazy, stupid, inept, insignificant, nothing, you know. It tried to intimidate me that way. So the ego plays hardball, really. Of course, because the ego is just us trying to play God, really. And so we're trying to convince us not to listen to anything that tells us that we're not God, that we're one with God, the same essence, but God is greater. We try to do anything at all to keep the continuity problem unresolved. Because we think that is our great blindness to reality is actually proof that we are becoming God. So all of this gets seen. It's seen. And just look and just see it. You just notice it and say, huh. In calm, quiet reflection, that's how we're supposed to spend our time. So if you expect this, and you have a culture, everyone says, oh yeah, I see that. You say, oh, of course. It's no big deal. We see this. A genuine culture, spiritual culture. People talk about this. They meet one another, and what are your, you know, spiritual insights, and how's your contemplation going? And we're sharing this. We see that we're trying to play God, and this keeps us investing in this continuity issue, keeping holding on to it, that spiritual blindness, and not being able to see reality. We think, well, reality is something that we create, you know, and people are willing to talk about that. So what do we do now is the question. That's the question right now in the world. What do we do now? Is the tide going to turn? Are we all suddenly going to? Yeah. Well, again, at the point of doom, that is when we cry out for help and we become aware of a quiet confidence that is not rattled by our doom at all. So, for many, they may bring themselves to the point of doom. And, you know, cannot interfere with that, because actually, that often, for many, that is the way to the Holy Spirit, is they have to get to a point where they really need to just say, hey, if there's any awareness of how to solve my problems, please let me know, because I'm at rock bottom, and I don't feel I can ever get up off rock bottom. And that's when the quiet confidence of the Holy Spirit is felt. So really what I've gotten from the Holy Spirit is the best thing to do is to withdraw from the situation, the planet, what's going through. Because the planet is headed towards doom, there's no question about it. And instead of trying to prevent that, let it play out, let it happen. Because really, that's the best case scenario, actually, is these things need to hit rock bottom. Because, at least in my case, I can see I had to hit rock bottom before I really repented and really changed and really accepted the Holy Spirit and started listening to the Holy Spirit. And from what I see, that's generally what happens. That's why you see Jesus said he came for the sinners, you know, meaning those who've hit rock bottom. Oftentimes you see those who are very much focused on the Holy Spirit. At some point they hit rock bottom, really hit rock bottom. And then they say, wow, you know, I really have to they ask for help, true help. So can a world hit rock bottom? Absolutely it can. Absolutely it can. And honestly, the Holy Spirit has told me, don't interfere with it. Don't interfere with it. Let it happen. Don't try and prevent it from happening. Don't you try to be the hero. Let the Holy Spirit says, let the Holy Spirit deal with the situation. Yeah, just so that's what I've been told. That's what's been shown to me is step back from the world, from this planet, from the situation. Don't be actively involved so much. Be involved behind the scenes, but you have to let it play out. You have to allow Spirit to really taste the ego's incompetence, that its incapacity to become prime creator. Spirit has to feel its incapacity to become prime creator. And at that point, see, Spirit thinks that's all there is. If it can't become prime creator, it's nothing. And that's when it cries out for help and says, wow, this is terrible. Please help. And the Holy Spirit's there and says, and there's this sense of quiet confidence, like, don't worry. Everything will be fine. There's a solution to this continuity issue. And then you start listening to the Holy Spirit. But so it's very evident to me and that the world is headed towards rock bottom. And I don't think it's a stretch for anyone right now to consider this is very likely. Very likely is what's taking place. To me it's obvious. It just the trending of the world is towards rock bottom. And the Holy Spirit has told me, see, I don't need to go through rock bottom, I already have. So the only thing I need to do is whatever the Holy Spirit tells me to do. So if the Holy Spirit tells me to get out of the way, then that's what I'll do. I'll get out of the way. Because the Holy Spirit knows best, no question about it. It knows how to solve the continuity problem, period. So if it tells me, get out of the way, you're getting in the way, then I'll get out of the way. Plain and simple. No argument or two ways about it. I had a situation yesterday at a gas station that I go to all the time, and the attendant is a acquaintance of mine, and we're on very friendly terms, and someone was at the gas station, some person, and they were in a very agitated state of mind, and they began yelling at the attendant, and I guess there was some history there, and they were upset about a lack of service or something, and they became irate, and the whole thing escalated into a very dangerous situation where I felt the attendant's life was in danger, really. And this went on and on and on. I just waited there, just watching, you know, just in case I needed to call the police or something. And the situation was not resolving at all. Was not resolving at all. And I said, wow, this is really bad. I mean, these two people were locked in a, you know, it was like this mental, psychic deadlock. And nothing could happen to resolve. And I asked the Holy Spirit, what do I do? And nothing came to mind. The Holy Spirit finally just said, you need to simply leave. Just leave. Just leave. I said, but there's this terrible conflict here. And the Holy Spirit says, I know, but just leave. I want you to just leave. Okay? And so I did. I just drove off. Very difficult to do because I wanted to help my friend, of course. And I wanted to help both equally. I don't want anybody getting hurt. Even though I didn't know the other person, they're still my friend. But the Holy Spirit said, don't intervene. Don't try to intervene. Just take off. Just leave. And I've been getting that more and more and more. Just leave. Just leave. Just leave. Let me take care of the situation. You don't need to do anything here. So I said, wow, okay. You're the boss. You know the how to solve a continuity problem for everyone. So if you say, put me in the best place to be helpful, but wherever you say, if you say being helpful is leaving the situation, then that's what I'll do. But it wasn't easy. Well, it didn't come easy. It's like, wow, abandoning my friend, in a dire situation, that's like, wow, that's not easy. But what did I know about the situation, really? Nothing, just superficial. Totally superficial. And again, I'm not the one that resolves the continuity problem. The only problem those two people have was the continuity problem. That's it. They didn't have any other problem. And I don't know the answer to the continuity problem. The Holy Spirit does. So if the Holy Spirit says, look, just leave, and that will help me, help them, then who am I to argue that? On what basis can I argue that? So a lot is being shown to me about this, about leaving, about not getting involved, staying out of the fight, stay out of the fight. The Holy Spirit has always told me that, stay out of the fight, don't get involved. You're not helping, the Holy Spirit says, you're not helping at all if you're into the fight, as it were. Stay out of the fight. So these videos, basically the theme that I've been presenting over and over is stay out of the fight. Withdraw, stay out of the fight. I'm presenting this option in these videos. Relocation, etc. It's just staying out of the fight. Stay out of it. Stay out of it. And this is, of course, a very unusual perspective that most people don't accept or accept it. They want to help, they want to do something, etc. But if the Holy Spirit's in charge of our salvation, and if it says stay out of the fight, then who are we to refuse that advice? Now, the Holy Spirit has total leverage over time. I've seen that. I've seen its leverage. As I clearly saw, it has complete control of time, totally leverage over time. It can do anything instantly, actually. Anything instantly. Holy Spirit doesn't need time to do anything. It can use time. It can take time. It doesn't have to use its leverage maximally, but it can. It can use its leverage maximally at any instant if it's called for and if we can accept it. So the idea of, well, how can we get withdraw from this situation? Well, the Holy Spirit can do anything in time and space, anything at all, instantly. And I've seen this. I've seen clearly its leverage. I've seen it. So I know this is true. I know it's true. Instantly, it can do anything instantly. Instantly, it can collapse all of time instantly, any instant, effortlessly. But it doesn't have to. Again, it can collapse a little bit here, a little bit there. Use leverage here, use leverage there. Whatever we can accept, it will use the leverage on our behalf. So, as far as getting out of the fray, leaving the situation in the hands of the Holy Spirit and just getting out of it, not interfering, not trying to play the hero. The Holy Spirit can bring that about, has the leverage to bring that about. No doubt about it. Now, I don't personally know how to do it, what's going to happen, but I know that the Holy Spirit has the leverage to do it. I know that's a fact. So it's just dependent on my own willingness to leave the situation. leave the situation. Turn the situation over the Holy Spirit entirely. Just say, it's play the hero and say that I have an answer or something. Because again, it probably has to do with hitting rock bottom, but that's actually, the Holy Spirit knows that some people, they have to hit rock bottom. I don't know if everybody does or not, but certainly I did. And so there's no question that can be utilized. And sometimes we try to help other people, we're preventing them from hitting rock bottom because we're afraid ourselves to hit rock bottom. They think, oh, I don't want them to because I don't want to either. But you know, for me, having already hit it, you know, I can say, well, I see the benefit of it, actually. It wasn't any fun, I'll tell you that. That's for sure. But at the same time, it was pretty adventurous. It's not like I completely freaked out. It was too intense. But the extreme intensity was like, whoa. You know, something with you, whoa, wow. There's still, you know, spirit was still there. But again, from one perspective, you know, like, wow, the intensity was too much. So it didn't destroy me, that is for sure. So you have to allow people their intensity if they really want to, you know, go through this in rock bottom thing. You know, it has to be allowed. And the tendency of us is to interfere and try to prevent it. No question about it. Throw a compromise, say, hey, you know, what can I do? Let me give you some drug or something, pharmaceuticals to try and prevent it. But, Holy Spirit says, just leave the situation, just get out of that situation. And that's what I have gotten. And the way and how away, I guess I will know. And because the Holy Spirit could collapse time instantly. Any situation that it sees is beneficial for us. It can bring it about like that. But for the sake of continuity, it doesn't do that because we feel, whoa, that's too abrupt. So it uses time on our behalf. But it only uses time on our behalf to solve the continuity problem. It doesn't need time except for that reason. It can collapse all of time instantly. All of time instantly and forever. And at the end, when it doesn't need, the continuity problem's been solved for everyone, it will collapse time, all of time. So can we go somewhere? Can we leave this situation? Absolutely. Absolutely. There shouldn't be any worries about that. And so each day we need to say, hey, you know, this situation here is going towards rock bottom. And if we're willing to focus on this one issue of who has the answer to the continuity problem, we don't need to go through any rock bottom. We've already done it. If you're listening to the Holy Spirit, then you don't need to go through rock bottom anymore. You don't need these problems. You don't need to be part of it. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. All right. Very great. I have to get about the day in the life now here in this madhouse. And work on, you know, leaving this madhouse. That is for sure. Okay, very great. That's it.